Again for Zuri Speaks. You all had a long weekend, I would say, or a weekday with all the food and stuff for the holidays you are celebrating. So I'm glad that you were able to come back and sit with me one more time here on Zuri Speaks, where we are providing, or we're a radio that provokes you to think as we uncover the truth to make us all free. Welcome back, my family. Let me tell you that the premises of this show is to provide a radio show that focuses on empowering Black men and women to step up to success in their families, their spirituality, their businesses, and their communities around the world. And although our main focus is concerning the Black community, there is no doubt that all communities can benefit from this show. And as I always say here as Zuri Speaks, we plan to bring a new flavor to radio, a forum that is designed with our listeners in mind. I will get it together here. I'm a little tongue-tied right now, but welcome. This is your girl, your host, Queen T, and I am excited to be back here once again in the studio. And listen, we're trying to go to an hour show, so I'm going to be bringing details to you that you can help support this so that we can move to an hour show, because as you know, we cannot get it all done in 30 minutes time. So more details will follow, but you can also go to my website at www.zurispeaks.com to get more information on how you can help us go to an hour time slot right here on KXXT 1010 on your AM dial. And I'm going to give a few shout outs or one loves before we get started. First of all, one love to the Creator. Without Him, I would not be here on this earth, and neither will you, whether you want to believe it or not. So one love to our Creator, the Most High. Thank you. And also to my mom, who the Creator used to get me here. My mother, Beverly Grant, in Macon, Missouri. Hi, Mama. How are you? Love you. And also, again, let me tell y'all, I had a wonderful birthday on Friday. I ended up back at Papa Do's restaurant again. That seems to be my spot. I have some new friends over at Papa Do's, so I'm going to give them a shout out today as well to the manager, Eric. Thank you for such a wonderful time for my birthday over at Papa Do's, and my server Crystal, and also Colin. So one love to you over at Papa Do's restaurant. And also I want to give a one love to my little, I call her my god niece, but she's in the hospital right now. So those of you who can see me in the studio, I still have her little bracelet on my arm from the hospital, and I plan to wear it until she comes home. So one love to my little god niece, Coco. I am praying for you, and I can't wait till you're up and bouncing and eating up all my food. So we are here with part two of our show that we did last week, Do Black Churches Keep Black Women Single? And I had a lot of feedback on Facebook. And so I'm going to try to cover some of the feedback, because, you know, you don't have much time to do what you got to do here in 30 minutes. That's why we need an hour show, right? I still want to give a shout out before I forget to my destiny partner, Ed Smith. I know you're listening. How you doing? One love to you as well. And to my children, one love to you as well. I have once again here on the phone from Greensville, South Carolina. I messed it up last week, but I'm going to get it right this time. Kenya Permenter, are you there, girlfriend?
I am there. Hello, everyone.
Hey, sister. Welcome back. Welcome back for part two of this hot topic. And, you know, we had such a wonderful time last week talking about it. And I hate to say that it's a wonderful time, but the truth be told that, you know, these are the things that people don't really want to talk about. And so that's why we're here to do that.
Right.
So welcome back to Zuri Speaks. And you know what? I'm going through stuff so fast. So let me quickly remind everyone who's listening that if you are not here in the Phoenix, Arizona area, that means you're listening to me on the internet. And I thank you for that. But you can also go back to the internet, ZuriSpeaks.com, and pick me up on podcasts, pick me up on Ustream, pick me up on internet streaming. All those will be archived there for you for any past show. So if you missed the show last week with Kenya and I, you missed a wonderful show. And I urge you to go back and check that part one out so you can check out part two and it all can fit together. Is that right? Okay, so let's go right into what we talked about last week before we get into the new stuff. We were talking about a young woman named Deborah Cooper who did an article about churches keeping black women single. And she had some very strong opinions about that. And I'm just going to briefly go over that a little bit because I don't want to stay on the same old topics that we did last week. But she said, first of all, she's a dating expert. And she said that traditional black churches, she charged them that they are the root cause for the high numbers of single black women in the U.S. And this is what we talked about last week because Kenya and I, we agreed on some things that she said, and then we disagreed on some things that she said. But one thing we did agree is that, you know, the order of what comes first in your life. So Kenya, can you once again, because you ran it down so beautifully last week, can you run down the order again of how it's really supposed to be for these young women so that way they'll have it right and they'll understand how it's going to be, especially once you get that husband?
Well, I'll say, first of all, you know, the order is very important in your life, because if you don't have an order, you're going to have chaos.
Mm-hmm.
So the first order is, you know, have a relationship with your creator.
Right.
Before you have a relationship with anybody else, because if you don't have a relationship with your creator, hey, you're going to get messed up.
Right.
All your relationships are going to be messed up, because that is the basis and basically the example of how all your other relationships should be.
Mm-hmm.
And then if you're married, you know, it'd be your husband.
Mm-hmm.
And then from that, you know, if you have children, your children. Mm-hmm. And then if you do business or ministry, whatever, there you go. But if you try to put a leader first before you put your husband, you're out of order.
And that's what I find out as we were talking last week. I find that out. And, you know, there's people who are going to disagree. And quite frankly, I don't really care. These are my opinions. But this is what I have seen over the years of being raised in the church from a little baby all the way up until now. And now I'm 44 as of Friday, and I've seen some things. So I'm not just speculating, but a lot of times single women, they do throw themselves so deeply into the ministry that they forget that they're women and that they, you know, they have to get out. You can't just, you know, constantly do that and hope. And you know what I was thinking about, Kenya, on the way over here, as a matter of fact, that the ratio for women to men in these churches, I mean, there's very few men, according, you know, when you put them together, there's a whole lot of women in church.
Yes.
And there's few men in church. So it's like, and then the ones who are there, most of them are married already.
Exactly.
So that could be a reason why a lot of women are still single. So then what do you think we're supposed to? I say we, because I'm not married yet either.
Me either.
Yeah. So what do you think? How do you think that we should handle that? What I'm asking you is it okay for us to go out and date outside the church, or do we just sit in the church and wait for Mr. Charming, tongue-speaking, you know, Bible-toting man to, you know, come along and sweep us off our feet? How do we handle that? What do you think?
I would say, first of all, you know, the Bible talks about a false abomination. Mm-hmm. A false balance is abomination.
Mm-hmm, okay.
Because in everything in our life, we have to have balance.
Right.
And you can't be so super spiritual that you're no earthly good.
Well, you better say that.
You better say if you really believe in your creator and your God, and you believe that he died to have, or you have an abundant life, he died for you to have balance in your life.
Okay.
He died for you to be able to experience joy. You know, sitting in your house all day long, you don't get any joy.
Right.
But you get joy when you connect with other people.
Right.
So if you just focus on just sitting in the church, and I kind of went through this.
Yes.
At a ministry where I was attending and serving, and I was an armor bearer, and the pastor, she was married. Before she got married, you know, we did a lot of things together ministry-wise and whatnot. But when her husband came, I understood, okay, now it just need to be him and her.
Mm-hmm.
But everything they went through, how about they brought me to it?
Right.
And I was like, there's no need for me to be here.
Right.
And then there was like church Monday through Friday. I think we only had maybe 2 days. And then I have 2 children.
Okay.
So it was church all the time.
Mm-hmm.
I was like, okay, if I really did want to talk to somebody, where was the time for me and this person to be? Because it was just church, and it was trying to be mandatory. And then when we're talking about truth, mm-hmm. and getting understanding for yourself, well, I went to my God and I said, I got some questions. This doesn't add up.
Right.
What he said, this is a false balance. This is what my God told me. This is a false balance. And so.
Wow. False balance.
This does not add up to your life. And then you have some ministries, and what it was more like a control spirit.
Okay.
Trying to control your life.
Mm-hmm.
Trying to tell you, I understand that, you know, the Bible says when you're single, you care for the things of how you may please the Lord, and when you're married, how you may please the world, which is your husband.
Right.
I understand that.
Right.
But then there's also balance.
Okay.
You know, I have my days where I just want to hear some nice jazz or,
yeah.
Look, I want to hear some R&B.
Okay.
You know. I don't always want to hear my gospel music.
Right.
You know, I want to hear something. I like songs that have meaning.
Okay.
You know, I like the old stuff, Al Bishir, New Edition, Deborah Cox, you know, all that good stuff.
The good stuff. So balanced. You know what? And I'm glad you brought that up, because I was kind of going that way. So that means, and you and I haven't talked about this, so this is like, mm-hmm. it's got to be in the spirit, because this is what I was thinking about too on the way over here. I kind of changed the show a little bit just by driving to the studio, because I was thinking about my first book that I wrote. This is a plug for my book, but don't call me about the book, because the book is being revised, so it's not available anymore right now. But it's called Sister to Sister, A Treasured Gift, Repairing the Gap in Sisterhood. And I wrote this book in 2007. Well, it's 14 chapters in this book, but the last chapter of this book is called So You Want to Be a First Lady.
Wow.
And in that chapter, I was thinking about it on the way over here, because I was in the chapter, I was talking about how so many women, and this is again from experience, because when I stopped playing and really got into church, the first thing I did, I became attracted to the men who would come to our church and preach. They were single, they were highly anointed, charismatic, and I was attracted to that. And mm-hmm. so I kept telling myself, I'm going to marry me a preacher. I'm
wow.
going to marry me a pastor. And since 1998, I have been, and I heard you mention that you were armor bearer to the first lady. And for those of you who are in situations, you don't know what an armor bearer is equivalent, almost equivalent to a personal assistant to that first lady. And so I was as well, but I was that to 3 pastors' wives. And mm-hmm. so like yourself, I saw a lot of things and heard a lot of stuff, you know, just being in that position. But mm-hmm. at the same time, well, I tell you this, and by being in that position, I soon told myself, I don't marry no pastor.
Yes.
I changed real quickly on that, just because it's a lot goes on. But I think that even being in the church and being around that anointing and that charismatic spirit that comes off of the pastors, I found that women, and I'm saying this because I did it myself, when the pastor is single, or the minister is single, you try to be at church all the time, and you try to put on your best everything to try to impress this guy.
Wow.
And I've And I don't want to call any churches because, you know, we're not here to do that. But there's, I was reading about a mega church that he was single for a long time. But when he got married, he lost a lot of his women out of the church.
Well, I've seen that.
You've seen that, too?
Mm-hmm.
And so so when you brought up the fact that being close to a pastor's wife like that, you know, we got to see a lot of things. And that's why I'm coming with this topic, because I saw a lot of things that I, and you know what? And to make it worse than that, some women even try to impress the married pastors.
Yes, they do.
You better start talking, Kenya, because you know my mouth will keep going.
Yes, I've seen that. I've seen that as well, because like he was saying, that you, the charismatic, the anointing, it becomes to be attractive. It makes people look better than what they really are. And so you begin to tap into what's not real.
Okay.
That's what it is. It's what's not real.
Right.
Because that's not who that person is.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
That's what they're empowered to do at that moment. But that's not who they really are.
Right.
You know, the person that really are is that person that might cuss you out one day.
Right.
Because they have a bad day. That's the real person. Uh-huh. It is not, you know, what you see these people up here getting here and preaching and everything. That's not who they really are. Because
right.
when they come down out of the anointing.
When a spirit lifts.
Trust and believe. You like, wait a minute, is this the same person?
Uh-huh.
Yeah, it's the same person. But mm-hmm. they were empowered to speak like they were speaking at that moment.
Right. And, you know, and I want to say, because I know on Facebook, because, you know, I have a lot of Facebook friends. So my Facebook friends who is listening, how y'all doing? I love y'all. Believe it or not, I really do. But some of them were saying that, you know, they were saying, no, it's not the church that keeps, you know, black women single. And the reason why I'm saying black women is because according to the statistics that we went through over last week, the Pew's, what was that, the American Pew's, or I forget what, the PEW Research Center's Forum on Religion and Public Life is where I got the statistics from. And they were saying that, you know, we are the highest number of single women in church are us. And so, but I had people on Facebook who were saying, you know, I don't think that, especially the men, they were saying, I don't think that the churches are keeping you guys single. I think it's, you know, you don't want to submit, you don't want to do this, you don't want to do that. Well, I don't know if that's true, because when you get so deep into church, you're really taught submission.
That's right.
You're taught submission. So that can't be the issue. But I want to clear it up to tell people that when I say that the churches are keeping black women single, I'm not talking about the church in, I guess I would say, a church as a whole. But mm-hmm. I'm talking about the different attitudes or actions that go on in some of the churches is what's keeping you single. The mentality.
Mm-hmm.
I would say the mentality, again, I'm going to marry me a pastor or a minister. So I'm going to stay here until one of these, either one of these married men becomes single, or he going to come off the street and, you know, get the anointing and then marry me. And then, like we said last week, that can be an issue too, because you know, once the spirit lift, you're married to a whole lot of stuff.
Yes.
Right. And so, you know, and we run out of time again. We got like 5, 6, 7 minutes left.
I know.
But yeah, I know what I'm telling you. But I want to go over this one thing again that we had talked about last week, because this is the thing that you and I both we disagreed on, what Deborah Cooper had said. And then she said the reason that there are so many single never married black women in the United States churches is because of the fact that some of the men that come there, they're either gay or they're already married, or they are coming off the street and they haven't got themselves together, trying to get themselves together. So again, don't call me and write me. I didn't say this. Deborah Cooper said this. I'm just telling you what she said. So you go on Facebook or you go on the internet and find her. But we'd already talked about, and that was my question again. So I don't want to leave this show without saying this one more time. Does this mean, are we allowed as single black women to go outside of our churches to date other men? Because as we talked about last week, a lot of churches teach us that if you go outside of your church, you know, and date other people, you're unequally yoked.
I found that interesting, you know, to be said. And if we really have a relationship with our God, mm-hmm. with your creator, did you understand that he's not a God of bondage?
Okay.
He's a God of freedom. Mm-hmm. And that everybody has different, we have different nationalities because we all can learn from one another.
Right.
And any time that you are going to have to stay within, that's like a camp. It's like being in a concentration camp. You can't go outside.
Right.
That's bondage.
Right.
That's, again, that's false balance.
Yes, false balance.
Because if we're really a body and we're working together, mm-hmm. then that's the rest of the body is outside the camp.
What about those women who say, they run across a young man in the church and they say, God told me that you're my husband.
Okay, first of all, we talked about order. You out of order.
I just thought I'd throw that in there because you know that is being said a lot.
I know. And, you know, and I had just recently put a Facebook post on because I've been coming in contact with a lot of people,
uh-huh.
you know, in physical contact, talking, even, you know, people that I've been counseling. And these women, they're loose. They're loose because they're throwing themselves at these men.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and even there's manipulation that goes on. And that's out of order. If you understand the order that was already set,
mm-hmm.
that if you begin, if you let him find you, because
mm-hmm.
that's his job, is to find you, then okay. everything will be well with you. But okay. then when you throw yourself out there, you're aggressive. What kind of character does it, what does that say about you as a woman?
Hmm.
What does that say about you as a woman when you put yourself out there, you throw yourself in a man? Do you not have any value about yourself to let this man pursue you?
Right.
What kind of value do you have for yourself?
Wow. Well, ladies, you know, you can be saved from that. Because I know, can you just, she just threw some knives, but you can be saved from that, you know. And then I guess the bottom line is that if we just realize, like you said, just realize the value that we have, and that if the person doesn't really want you, then, and we talk, you know, you and I talked about this. Let me backtrack, because you and I talked about this. Even if the Spirit told you that, you know, a certain person is supposed to be with you. We talked last night, actually, about, I think the word you used was free will.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Elaborate on that. Talk to us.
Okay, even though it can say you can, maybe he did tell you that uh-huh. that is your husband or whatnot,
mm-hmm.
but this man has a choice.
Okay.
He has a choice to receive you
mm-hmm.
or reject you.
Mm-hmm. That's what I want to hear.
If he doesn't choose to listen to, you know, the voice of God,
mm-hmm.
then that's okay.
Right.
Because still God has somebody still waiting for you.
Right. That's the good news. That's
it
the good
is.
News. So, you know, we're not out there by ourselves. You know, if I heard this pastor long time ago. I went to a conference long time ago, and I heard her say when she was delivering her message, she said that she was married, but then her husband was, you know, leaving her and all that stuff. But then he would come back. And she would just, it was driving her crazy because she really wanted her marriage to work or whatever have you. But the bottom line is, she said that the father told her that if he doesn't want you or he doesn't want to treat you the way you're supposed to be treated or need to be treated, then I'll just repossess you back unto myself.
Wow.
And I thought that was deep. So,
yes.
Single ladies out there, you know, if the person that, you know, God, if God told you that he's your husband and he don't want to be, don't worry, you'll get repossessed back into the Father who has somebody else for you. So, girl, I am so glad that you joined me. And you know what? I'm going to have you join me on some future shows because we have a lot to talk about.
Yes, we do.
We have a lot to talk about. And so I want to just briefly ask everybody to join me again here next week. And you know what? I don't even know what next week's show is. I forget. But I can tell you on the 18th of January, I can tell you that I'm having a special guest coming on. His name is Darnell Smith, and he is the entrepreneur creator of, they call them mini billboards. And he just took a large billboard, the concept of a large billboard, and he made it to where you can actually, it goes on the television screen. It's real small, and it's just like a mini billboard, like the ones you see out there that always flipping and advertising and things like that. Well, he created this, they call mini billboards. Very fascinating story, but that's not the reason why I'm having him on. The main reason is he has a rags to riches story. He was homeless. Wow. And, you know, the father gave him an idea, and then he took that idea, and now he is doing all right. So we're going to touch next time when he comes on the 18th, we're going to touch on the business part, because remember, we're trying to build communities. We're trying to build up you spiritually, business wise, your families, everything here at Zuri Speaks. So once again, leave us your comments, ZuriSpeaks.com, or see me on Facebook, www.facebook.com/Zuri Speaks, or you can call me 203 Ask Zuri. And you could also catch Kenya on Facebook too. She's under Kenya Permenter. I'm going to try to spell you today. Kenya Permenter. Did I do good?
You did very well.
Wow. Wonderful. Wonderful. And so I thank you all for listening here again today. Remember, we are going to talk in the near future about Zuri Speaks going to an hour time slot. And in that hour time slot, I have so many wonderful things to do and so many special guests coming on, but I'm going to need your help. So please contact me at my web at ZuriSpeaks.com or my Facebook, and just stay tuned, because I'm going to put more information out there for you so we can do that and make that happen. So thank you for joining me, Kenya.
You're welcome. And I will to the next show.
Yes, girl. And I'm going to talk to you later. And so thank you all out there for listening here on Zuri Speaks on KXXT 1010 on your AM dial. One love. Thank you.